Ladies and gentlemen, we are here for the first episode post the intro of Good Anarchist, Bad Anarchist. I'm Adam Navarro-Williams. I play the good anarchist. We've got my partner, Larken Rose, who plays the bad anarchist. And the part of today will be a little bit new for Larken and for Cole. We'll only be using our guest, Cole's first name, because he is an active duty police officer in the United States, and he's not authorized to speak to us, certainly not about these type of topics. The first thing that we will always do, each of us, when we take our turn, so the schedule is going to be, we're going to be a half an hour. I will be kind of hosting, and Larken and Cole will be going back and forth. And then next episode, we'll be doing switching the roles, Larken and I, with our next guest. And the first thing that we'll do is edify the guest, because everyone that we're talking to is going to be a courageous person to come and talk to us. So I just want to say first thanks to Cole, who we've really found to be a great person and someone who understands a lot of things and who tries to do his best to work within the system. So I want to acknowledge him for speaking with us and for coming on and for being such a great first guest. So the way we're going to do this is I will ask each of our folks here one of five questions, and then they will get a chance to ask each other questions. So we're going to go ahead and start. So Cole, how do you define effective leadership?
Okay, effective leadership is obviously, because of the name, if it's going to be effective, it has to be properly applied. And then to me, that means the leader has to know the people that he's speaking with or trying to lead. To put things in perspective to where they can understand, where there's no confusion or very little confusion, if there can never be no confusion. And that leader does his best to get on the whatever level the people are that he's leading, consistent, proper, and just knowing his audience. To me, that's effective leadership.
Thank you. Larken, how do you define effective leadership?
I would mainly distinguish between leadership and rulership. To me, an effective leader basically leads by example, such that other people look at him and approve of what he's doing or what he believes or what he says or whatever, and wants to emulate or go along with whatever his plan or organization is, not because he's big and bossy and makes them bow to his will, but because they understand an opportunity to do a joint venture that benefits everybody, not as a command and obeyer, but just as somebody who says, yeah, well, I'll go along. It's like a good idea.
Okay. All right. So Larken, what is the actual role of the police in modern society?
Well, literally their role is to force everyone else to obey the dictates of politicians, whatever politicians enact as law. Rather, the ideal thing is to protect and serve and keep people safe. But the actual literal job description isn't just stop murderers and stop thieves and stop arrest anybody who disobeys any of the commands that come from the rule.
Thank you. Cole, what is the actual role of the police in modern society?
I think the actual, the actual role of a police officer in our society is a combination of law enforcer and police officer. And by those, there's a combination of, yes, enforcing laws that are on the books, at the same time engaging with the community and putting forth an example and dealing with each situation on an individual basis. And yes, part of that is enforcing the laws that were put into place by elected officials.
Okay. Thank you. So, Cole, how can society create security for its citizens without sacrificing liberty?
Oh, man. That is a deep question. Create security without sacrificing liberty.
Yeah.
Security is, in my view, is protection from those who would violate the personhood, violate a person. It seems to me that whenever there's a connection between security and liberty, and I think it's like that George Bush thing with the what was that he put into place back when after 9/11? I can't remember the name of it.
The Patriot Act.
The Patriot Act. Mm-hmm. It seems to me that the reality is, as a rule, if you want security, there has, and it's irritating to me, but there has to be some liberty that's forsaken. And that is part of what has brought me to be talking to you guys in the first place anyway. I know that's a crummy, stumbling answer, but I haven't really given that much thought as far as an application to what I really think is applied there. And
okay. Thank you.
It's just, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Cool. Larken, how can society create security for its citizens without sacrificing liberty?
I think the only person who has the right to give up liberty is the person whose liberty is being given up. If somebody, for example, wants to live in a giant concrete cage because they feel safe, they get to choose that for themselves. They don't get to choose that for anybody else. So to me, society doesn't ever get to decide that somebody should give up their liberty in the name of security. Only the individual has that right. And ultimately, to me, security and liberty amount to basically the same thing, which is freedom from aggression from somebody else. And when government says we're going to spy on you and control you and aggress against you, but it's to protect you, it's to keep you secure, that's the opposite of security. That's sort of victimizing me. That's what you're doing to protect me again. So that's the short version.
Okay, thanks. Larken, how can we promote moral behavior?
I think for the most part, most people, not all, but most people already have enough in common with their moral codes that they can get along just fine, except that most people also believe that political elections and rituals give certain people an exemption from morality, and that puts us at war with each other when we don't agree. For example, Democrats and Republicans, they could get along just fine if they both understood, just spend your own money, don't try to spend your neighbor's money. And they would do that if they stopped imagining an exemption for government from the basic rules of morality, which is the most basic one, is don't attack anybody, even if you have a badge and a law and a, you know, politician saying it's okay. The non-aggression principle is sort of the foundation of a peaceful, civilized society.
Okay. Cool. How can we promote moral behavior?
Well, the word moral has a lot of meaning to different, a lot of different meanings to different people. What is moral to me may not be moral to you, may not be moral to Larken. So I think the first thing that has to happen, and it won't happen, but the first thing that has to be attempted is every human being on, well, let's talk about this nation, every human being in this nation, same moral code, and to promote morality, there has to be an agreement on what morality is, and I don't see that happening anytime soon, making an agreement on what is morality for me and for you and for the next guy.
Okay, thank you. All right, final question here before you guys get to ask each other stuff, looking forward to that. So Cole, what is fair?
What is fair? Yeah. Boy, you talk about answering off the cuff here, because I've never even considered that question in this context. fair would be, I suppose, taking in a totality of all the circumstances involved in whatever the situation is and coming to a mutual agreement.
Okay, cool. Larken, what is fair?
I think the way most people use the word fair is it's arbitrary and meaningless and nothing. It means I wish the world was different than it is. To me, the only fair that actually has any objective, basis for it is non-aggression. What's fair is I get to run my life and you get to run yours and we don't attack each other. And even if you do things I don't like, if you're not threatening or harming people, even if you get filthy, stinking rich by voluntary means and I'm poor, to me, that's actually fair. And what's not fair is for me to come rob you. So I would base the only rational view of fairness I can think of is non-aggression. Don't attack other people.
Okay, fantastic. So, Larken, why don't you go ahead and ask your questions? You got 10 minutes.
All right. Okay. So first question, just to make sure we're sort of talking in the same terms about the same reality. Do we agree that every law passed by government is a threat of physical force, and that the job of a law enforcer is to use whatever level of force it takes, up to and including deadly force, to make other people comply with the commands that are enacted as laws?
I suppose, and let me say this, Adam, popping out at some point, so I may have to get some stuff, but that one came across pretty well.
Okay.
So you're saying any law has it as potential the use of physical violence the use of physical violence and or leading up to deadly force.
Right.
Is that what you're asking?
Yeah, basically, do you think the law is a command backed by a threat of violence or a threat of force?
I suppose if we take it all the way from a jaywalking ticket that's not paid or not taken to court and it turns into a warrant, then if that that person has a warrant out for his or her arrest and it's found out on a traffic, on a pedestrian stop or something like that, then if that person runs from the police, certainly there's not going to be deadly force used in that situation. However, if the officer decides to pursue and the person gets to the house or gets to a weapon to use that weapon to resist arrest, I suppose it would be deadly force there. So I can't say, I think I understand what you're asking. I cannot say that every single law that is on every single city statute is going to wind up in physical violence or deadly force. I can't say that unequivocally, no.
Okay, I think that answered what I intended to ask anyway. So, number two, assuming you think that have the moral right to do certain things which some people don't have the right to do, from whom and how did they acquire such special rights?
Okay, I caught about 80% of that, but I think I got it. The police authority, the authority of the police officer is granted by the entity that hires them. And yes, the authority they have to enforce the laws on whatever books and whatever area they're in is given to them by elected officials, if that answers your question. If not, let me know.
Okay, and just a follow-up, I assume that you say that the elected officials got that authority by being elected from the people.
That's what I would have to say, sir, yes.
Okay. We're trying to keep this brief, so I hope we have follow-ups because I'd like to discuss some of that. But number three, does an officer of the law bear the same moral responsibility for what he does as anyone else would who did the exact same thing? Or is a police officer not to blame for what he does as long as he's doing his job and enforcing the law?
Okay. It's a very interesting question, I think, but you'll have to try it again because there's one or two words that I missed that were very important. So please repeat that.
Okay. Does an officer of the law bear the same moral responsibility for his actions as anyone else would who did the same thing, or is he not to blame as long as he's just doing his job and just enforcing the law?
I say that every human being is responsible for every single action that he does or does not do.
Cool. I agree. Number four. And you might not like this one, but I have to ask it. Do you believe it is moral and tolerable that your paycheck comes from taxpayers who are forced to hand over their money, regardless of whether they want your services and regardless of whether they approve of what you do?
In the nation we live in today's economy, and the way this nation is set up, the answer is yes.
Okay, you do believe it's moral?
I'll have to say, the way you asked the question, I'll have to say yes.
Okay. And number five, and this is a tough one. At what point do you believe people have a moral right to disobey and resist, even forcibly resist, things that are done in the name of law enforcement?
That would have to be up to the individual and how strongly they believe that the whatever law that they are resisting, whatever the situation is that you have in mind, in refusal to obey a law, that has to be in their mind that they are willing to endure whatever consequences come from that decision.
Okay, those are my five.
All right, great. Cole, you've got 10 minutes.
Okay. You have referenced earlier, the last time we tried to set up about leadership, you referenced it again and in this conversation, morality or morals. What is your morality based upon?
My morality is actually based upon, even though I was raised Christian, I'm not religious, I'm not Christian anymore. In part, it's based upon what I basically feel as human conscience and empathy. Like if I see somebody beating up an innocent person, I don't have to go to a law book to know that that's wrong. Something inside me as a human being who's not a sociopath says that's very bad, that shouldn't be happening. So in a way, it's an internal thing. It's direct access. It's not based on a religion. It's definitely not based on a law book. But the foundational thing that I believe based on empathy and compassion is that every individual owns himself and nobody should aggress against somebody else without their consent.
Okay. So what I understand you saying is your sense of morality and your definition of empathy, and I forget what other word you used, is based upon you and is not universal. You cannot say that what you believe is moral is universal.
It's not universal. The basics are shared by a whole lot of people, but even the basics aren't shared by everybody.
Okay. So someone who was outside of that whole lot of people, would you be willing to put them in a cage if they violated your morals?
Depending on the degree to which they commit aggression. Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't cage someone for stealing a candy bar. But if somebody tried to commit murder against me or anybody else or something, you know, that drastic, I would not at all be opposed to being defensive force to stop them, including detaining them. And I happen to think that prison is a really bad punishment for almost anything. I don't think it's very effective. But I do believe in forcibly detaining people to stop them from committing aggression against others.
Okay. And since you weren't allowed to follow up, I had two or three follow-ups, but I'll respect that you didn't get to, no. So
Go right ahead.
Okay. So based upon your view of what morals are, depending on the level of the violation of those morals by your moral code by someone else, you would be willing to cage someone for their behavior?
Yes, in certain circumstances.
Okay, here's a scenario. Say tomorrow at work, I get a call from a mom who said she walked in on her husband, who is the stepfather of her six-year-old daughter, and he was in the act of sexually molesting her. and you can, you know, in your mind, whatever that involves, I'm not going to get detailed. So after a cursory investigation, I have probable cause to arrest this person and take his liberty away. So on the way down to jail, he looks at me and he asks why I am taking him to jail. And I tell him, for child molestation, how would you answer this question if you were me? When he looks at me and says, who are you to tell me that my behavior is not moral?
Okay. I would say, I am me. I use my judgment just as you used your judgment to decide it was okay for you to do that to a child. I use mine to use force to make you not able to do that to a child.
Okay. So because I'm wearing a uniform and I have a badge, I am able, because of what elected officials have said is a crime, I'm able to take away his liberty and cage him.
I don't think the badge or the uniform or any of that or the law has anything to do with whether it's justified or not. I think I would have the same right to do that that you would.
Okay. So his morals were outside of my morals, so I was able to use force, up to deadly force, to take him into custody.
Yeah.
I would. Okay.
In the situation you just described, I would myself, without a badge and without a law.
Okay. And I think I'm on number four, Adam, I think.
Go ahead.
Okay. How do you differentiate physical aggression from psychological or emotional aggression?
This is sort of gets to the basis of libertarianism, because there is, you know, sort of, there's a lot of emotional abuse, especially to children who are basically captives of their parents. I'm very reluctant to call most words aggression to the point that they would justify forcible response. I mean, there's a bunch of, you know, there may be an abusive spouse that says nasty things to his or her partner constantly. A threat of violence falls within the realm of aggression. Very little else does. That doesn't mean it's good. It means, to me, most words do not justify a response of force. Only words that are actually a threat of physical force. So if somebody's abusive, I would definitely try to convince the victim of it to leave. But I don't believe force is justified in response to people basically being assholes.
Okay, so the words... We attach our own meaning to words. Words are just noises without meaning attached to them.
Was that a question?
No. I remove agreement.
Yeah, we.
Okay.
And we perceive words differently too.
I'm in agreement with you there. Okay. Today, as I had messaged you privately. On duty today, there was and I'm going to ask a question here, so bear with me. One call went out that a woman, the caller said a woman in a nearby apartment was screaming for help. She did not want to get involved. Another call went out, and this was my call, that a woman, a female, was seen getting out of a truck. She was tied by her hands and around her waist, and she was running down the road screaming. This woman wanted, the caller wanted to remain anonymous. And another call was a male and female walking down the street, and the male was choking the female. That person did not want to get involved. And obviously other people that saw this going on, driving down the street, neighbors or whatever, no one got involved. Who would you recommend that these victims call for help?
It depends in part on where they are. If they're anywhere near me, I recommend they call me. I don't care who is called to intervene. Like, I think somebody with a badge and a uniform has the same right that I do to forcibly intervene and stop someone from victimizing somebody else or to rescue somebody. Obviously, the world has to thugs. It also has way too many cowards who won't even get involved to the degree of like calling somebody else. I absolutely believe in defensive force. I believe it's inherently righteous. It doesn't require a badge or a law. That what you have the right to do to defend somebody, I have the right to do too. Unfortunately, a lot of people won't actually do it, and a lot of people who would do it don't have the ability. Like they're too weak or whatever. But I think anybody has the right to stop people from victimizing others, like all the situations you described, and anybody has the right to hire somebody else to stop them on their behalf, as long as they're just acting as a human being, doing what's inherently moral, instead of pretending to have special rights and act on behalf of basically a ruling class. So in all those cases, I absolutely would support the use of defensive force to protect those victims by anybody, badge or not.
Oh, I, you might be surprised how much I agree. I wish there were more people like you and probably like Adam, although Adam hasn't stated exactly that. But there's not. So that would be the end of my five questions.
Fantastic, Cole. Well, this is an extraordinary first episode. The host will always close with some promotion, because we got to move things forward to keep serving people. So, you know, you can always buy a book from Larken. You can take a personal development course from me, or you can do any of the entrepreneurial projects that Larken and I are involved with. Or if you want to support Cole, you can pay taxes or run a red light. All right, guys. So.
Oh, that was low. That was low.
You guys have a fantastic evening, and really enjoyed this first episode.
Thanks. I hope we'll be around too.
I appreciate what you guys are doing.
Hey, thanks so much, Cole. Fantastic. Good night.
All right. Bye-bye.